what you always wanted to know about your shortwave antenna: the radiation characteristics of a loop at different frequencies and heights above ground. It's consisting of one wavelength wire and it receives little noise due to its frequency selectivity. The DIY loop antenna is popular for shortwave, especially among radio amateurs. Here on Electronics Unmasked we examined and tested a number of lambda loops in the frequency range 145 to 2400 MHz. This video is about loop antennas for lower frequencies, namely 7 to 28 MHz, corresponding to the amateur radio bands 10 meters to 40 meters. Radiation characteristics are definitely depending on the frequency and on the height above ground. And in addition, ground conditions may play a role. We will analyze this using a loop antenna that we dimensioned for the 40 meter band. Before we dive deep in the analysis of antennas, I want to give you a hint. PCBWay is a great supplier to support you in your hobby and your professional activities. They are providing a very interesting portfolio on PCBs, assembly services, custom metal, plastic parts and more. And then look at the impressive number of customers and partners relying on PCBWay. Take the easy way with PCBWay. First, we are feeding it with a 7 MHz signal, so that the wavelength is corresponding to its circumference. The current distribution is nicely indicating the fundamental resonance. We are seeing two current maxima and minima on the loop. By the way, I'm using the program NEC for the simulation. Doubling the frequency, we are getting not only two, but four maxima and minima. Three times the fundamental frequency yields six maxima, and at four times the frequency there are eight. In the following, we will analyze the 40 meter loop's radiation characteristics at 7 MHz, at 14 MHz and at 28 MHz. With 10 meters side length, the quadratic loop is covering an area of 100 square meters. And that is quite large and you certainly cannot build it up just everywhere you want. To give you an idea, I'm showing a sketch of a 10 meter, 20 meter, 40 meter and 80 meter loop antenna, each of the height of the corresponding half wavelength. Even when you have enough space for a 40 meter loop, you probably need to make a compromise on the height above ground. But will you still get a suitable radiation pattern? We will find out by computing different heights. We start at 20 meter height corresponding to a half wavelength. The elevation of the main beam lobe is at 30 degrees, which is not ideal. Actually, we would prefer 12 degrees, but okay, we don't lose much of radiation power at the lower angles. At a height of 16 meters, the main lobe is rising to 40 degrees elevation, and the lower the height above ground, the less energy is radiated to the side. As an effect of this, the horizontal gain is decreasing, even when the radiation pattern is retaining its shape. The three-dimensional radiation pattern is showing us the complete picture. Basically, no energy is lost, it's simply radiated in a different direction. Next, we are looking at higher frequency bands. At 14 MHz and 20 meter height, we are obtaining a radiation lobe at around 14 degrees elevation. At lower antenna heights, we are also losing antenna gain, but by far not as much as in the 40 meter band. The cloverleaf shape of the horizontal diagram practically doesn't change. I particularly like the 3D representation, which looks like a growing flower. Beautiful looking radiation patterns, isn't it? So on 8 meters height or more, this antenna would be pretty suitable for the 20 meter band. Now let's see the results in the 10 meters band at 28 MHz. We can achieve pretty flat beam angles from a height of just 8 meters. The horizontal diagram is no surprise, and the 3D radiation pattern shows no matter what height your antenna is, most of the energy is radiated to the site. Okay, what are you getting out of this now? You can use these computer simulations to estimate what compromise you are making with your antenna at feasible heights above ground. There is one more thing we want to analyze. An antenna's radiation also depends on the ground condition. Let's look at that for the loop antenna now. We can simulate different ground conditions using NEC. Options are average ground, poor ground, good ground, perfect ground, salt water and fresh water. We carried out the previous calculations with average ground and now we are comparing them to the other conditions. Over poor ground, a little more energy is radiated perpendicular to the sky. Over good ground, perfect ground, salt water and fresh water, it is a little less. We can summarize the results as follows. The nature of ground has little influence on the radiation of the loop. I think the differences are too small to notice during operation. It's not like vertical antennas where good grounding is important. At 7 MHz and low height, a lot of energy is radiated to the sky instead to the site. That's a compromise you're making. Similar to the resonance modes of our loop antenna, the amateur radio bands are multiples of the fundamental frequency, allowing us to use the antenna for the higher bands. In our example, for 14 and 28 MHz, you're getting really suitable radiation characteristics at feasible heights above ground. While the gain is lowering, the shape of the horizontal diagram is independent from the height. We examined the radiation characteristics of a shortwave loop antenna. An alternative to the 40 meter loop would be a smaller 20 meter loop with 5 meter side length. In case you are interested in any further analysis, let me know in the comments. Just for the sake of completeness, the high impedance of loop antennas is matched to 50 ohms using balloons. In coming videos, we will examine the influence of the shape and inclination. And we will show how to shift the main beam direction without changing the build. Now, stay tuned and don't forget to support the channel. See you soon in the coming episodes.